Okay, so let's start the session with Anton Musa, who will talk about quasi-linear singular SPTs and paracontrol curves.
Thank you. So first of all, I'd like to thank Mate for the invitation and the opportunity to talk. So I'm going to present you an ongoing work with my PhD advisor Ismail Bayal. And first of all, I will introduce for you high-order paracontrol calculus, which is basically a work of my advisor Ismail Bayal with Frédéric Bernito in Nantes. Then I will present how they use those tools for solving semi-linear singular SPDs, and then how we adapt those tools to deal with quasi-linear SPDs. So first, I will start with an introduction that will be useful for a lot of people, but just to remind the general picture. So what we are aiming to solve here is a certain equation such as the generalized prime equation and the generalized KPZ equation. So here, C is a noise, a space noise for GPAM and a space-time noise for GKPZ. So there is a singularity. Those SPDs are singular because we have a multiplication of distribution, which is not well defined in general. So here and here, here. So a product of two order function or distribution is well defined if the sum of the irregularity is big enough. So here, Schoner estimates allow us to expect U to be alpha order if the noise is alpha minus 2 order. So those SPDs are singular for this condition. So the higher the dimension is, the more irregular the noise is, and the more singular the equation is. So here, I'm dealing with quasi-linear equation. That is, I don't have a linear leading term here. And D is a smooth enough function with values in the compact of this set. This is to ensure that this operator is a uniform elliptic. And since the Laplacian of U is of the same regularity of the noise, we have a singularity in the leading order term here. This term is ill-defined. So as we even told us, there are different approaches to this problem. The first one was by Otto and Weber, and then this work that Scott will describe after, so I won't say much about it. There was a work by Folland and Guglielmi where they were using paracontrol calculus and doing some paracomposition. There was a work by Arnaud de Buch, Martina Hoffmanola, and Ismail Bayal where they used first order paracontrol calculus to perform a fixed point to solve the equation, and this work that Eva described to us. So the general idea is coming from Rothbard's path, where we can multiply two distributions, U and Xi, if we can we can multiply a distribution that looks like Z with Xi if we know how to multiply Z by Xi. So there are two general theories to answer this problem. The first one is the theory of regularity structures that most of you already know from Martin Ayer. And there are also the paracontrol calculus introduced by Guglielmi, Keller, and Perkovsky. And using those two different theories, we can give a meaning to SPDs such as GPAM or GKPZ. For a relation of those two theories, you can look at the work of Martin and Perkovsky that give an expression of model distribution with a Paley-Little Wood theory, or another work of Bayan and Oshino using the framework of high-order paracontrol calculus. Okay, and there is a probability part, that is the renormalization that Eva was talking about. So, for example, one cannot take a point-wise product almost surely because it is not well defined, so we need a renormalization procedure such as this one with a different we need a renormalization step. So here I will only present analytic work, and I will not talk about the renormalization. For us, every function of the noise will be well defined and given by a renormalization procedure. This is not what I'm going to study here. Okay, so I will try to describe the theory of high order power control calculus. So first of all, if I take a distribution, I can tell that it is the limit of its Fourier series, and I get the Paley-Littlewood decomposition as follow, with each delta n f localized in a frequency on this annulus. So I can formally decompose the product of two distributions according to this decomposition, and I separate the sum in three terms. So here the frequency of f are much greater than those of g. Here the frequency of f are much smaller than the frequency of g, and here the frequency of f and g are of the same order. So we call this the power product of f with g, the power product of g with f, and the resonant term. And this is the resonant term that captures all the singularity of the multiplication problem. So for all distribution f and g, those two terms are well defined, and what might be singular is this resonant term. So this is using the Fourier theory with the Paley-Littlewood decomposition, but this doesn't work on manifold. This will be why I will use different tools. But we have this theorem that tells us that we can multiply two distributions given that the sum of their regularity is large enough, strictly greater than zero. And we even have a more precise description in this formula. The resonant term, its regularity is given by the sum of the two indices. And for the power products, it depends on the regularity. Recall that alpha is negative here, so alpha plus beta and alpha plus beta are strictly less than beta. And if the term at the bottom of the power product is a distribution like this, we got a smoother term than f because beta is positive. But if the term under the bottom of the power product is a function, we do not gain regularity. That is, alpha is less than alpha plus beta. And this would be very important in the study of singular SPDs. And I recall that this condition is only necessary for the resonance term. So as I told you, we do not have, we can't use a Paley-Littlewood Fourier manifold. So the idea is to consider the Laplacian. So here I will work with the Laplacian on the torus, but you can think of a Riemannian manifold with a Laplace Veltroni operator. So this Laplacian generates a semi group, and the good hypothesis, it has a very nice property and regularizing property. So we have an analog of the Paley-Littlewood decomposition and the Fourier theory. So given a distribution f, it is the limit of its Fourier series, for example. And the analog in our setting is that the each semigroup give a regularization of a function f. And we can rewrite this as an integral here. And this will be the analog of the Paley-Littlewood decomposition of a distribution. And so using those tools, we can define, for example, Bessel space and alpha order functions and distribution on a manifold. And in the case of the torus, there is an explicit computation that tells us that the Fourier transform of Pt is given by this, and the Fourier transform of Qt is given by this. And we can see that here, Pt is localized on a ball of radius 1 over square root of t, and with this term. And the Fourier transform of Qt is localized on an annulus of frequency of the order 1 over square root of t. So that is really an analog of SL who project on frequency lower than n, and delta n who project on frequency of on an annulus of order 2 to the power of n. So really this analogy guides us to perform all the analytic parts of the work. Okay, so I won't go into much details here because it's quite technical, but we can define space-time power products in this setting. So here, those two terms are decoration, they are only here for technical reasons, but here you can see that the power product of A and B is given as a Pt of A, Qt of B, and the resonant term of Qt of A, Qt of B. So if I recall the Fourier settings, we can see that Sn and Pt have the same role, and Qt and delta n have the same role, and again here. So really, the parabolics can be really complicated in appearance, but basically it's the same idea in the parameter root settings. It's just more technical for different reasons. So this proposition is here to tell us that we did the job of describing functions that looks like reference functions. That is, if I take a function U that is paracontrolled by the references function Z, that is U equal paraproducts of Z by V plus a smoother rest, then its variation looks like the variation of Z with V as the Bobigny derivatives of U. And this will be useful, for example, if you want to understand the solution of our SPDs, this will give us what they locally look like.
Yeah, just a question or remark. So the V actually is the coefficient I presented before, no? No, here on the slides. When you look at V, the Bobigny derivatives, is the coefficient I presented before, the one.
Yeah. All this happens.
And the Z is like the recentering of the trees or the stochastic process.
The Z will be the stochastic references object that we can represent by trees in regular structure.
So you have like a one-to-one correspondence between the expansion you will do with the trees and the one you do with the paracontrol calculus.
Yeah, this is the work of Ismail with Oshino, where they start from regular G-structures, and they are expressing all this with a paracontrol distribution, and that's what they are doing in the work. So all this can be reformulated with regular G-structure. This is like the Wong-Zakai of Martin. Here we work with a parabolic metric because we want to study parabolic SPDs. Okay, so there is a useful analogy between paraproducts and Itô stochastic calculus. So the basic Itô formula for a product of Martingale is an analog of the parabolic decomposition. And we have two tools that we use, that is the Itô formula for that tell us how, that describe the, for Martingale, the function f of the Martingale. We have the same object for paracontrol calculus, that is Boni paralinearization, that tells us that f of a looks like a for a smooth function f. And as we have a bracket full for stochastic integrals, we have a continuity result for a corrector that comes from the works of Gubinelli, Perkovsky, and Inkela. That is a continuity estimate on an operator like this. So we give no details on those two points. So this is a result that actually goes back to Boni, that is that in our settings, that is that if f is a smooth enough function, f of u looks like u locally. So this is like a first order expansion of u, and this is exactly what this will play the role of Taylor formula in regular G-structure. So we need higher order expansion. For example, at order 3 this becomes more complicated, but we can write we have an expansion of the nonlinearity in terms of u square and u cube, and for a smoother remainder. So this basically tells us that if you want to deal with a nonlinearity up to a remainder of regularity 4 alpha, we only need to study u, u square, and u cube. Okay, and we also need continuity estimates on this corrector. So this was done by in this work. So we have two conditions of the exponent of the arguments. This condition tells us that this product is actually ill-defined, that we need to perform to use the corrector, and this is an analog of the condition for the resonant product. If the sum of all regularity exponents is great enough, we can extend using this operator. So this is all the tools from high order paracontrol calculus that we can use to solve semi-linear singular SPDs. So I take the most simple example, that is PAM. So I take you the formal solution of the PAM equation. I use paraproducts to decompose this product as follow. So remember that here, since u is expected to be a function, this has the same regularity as the noise, but here we have a bit more of regularity. So I can rewrite this like this. This term is alpha minus 2 over the regularity of the noise, and this is a bit more regular. So using Schroeder estimate, I can show that we can show that u is given by this expression. So Schroeder estimates are used to tell that this gives a 12th order remainder, and we get a paracontrol description of a potential solution u. And for this, we use another paraproduct p tilde that is intertwined with p by this relation. So this is very important to deal with high order paracontrol calculus. I will explain a bit later why. And so the remainder here is explicitly given by this expression. And here we see that we have a product between u and xi, which is ill-defined, and we use the corrector c to get this expression. So this is an expression that depends only on the noise, so this is a renormalization matter, and I consider it is given to me. And now this term is singular if this condition is not verified, so we see that we gain a bit compared to the earlier condition where there was only one alpha.
I have a question for, so you have no divergences in the commutator?
Which commutator?
I mean the one, I mean you have this, this one.
Yeah, for first order expansion, for example, for PAM in 2D.
You don't need to renormalize this commutator? Or?
No, for PAM in 2D, this is well defined because is well defined if alpha plus alpha plus alpha minus 2 is strictly greater than 0. For PAM in dimension 2, this is enough. But for PAM in dimension 3, this is not the case, and you have to perform
renormalization on the commutator.
You have to first perform expansion of this commutator because you see here you have u and not just an expression of the noise. Oh. You renormalize only expression of the noise. So first you will have to expand this to get only expression of the noise and then renormalize it.
Okay.
To be clear after. So for a first order PAM, the only singularity is the product between u and xi, and this is the only term that you have to renormalize for PAM in dimension 2. It's like in a regularity structure, the more the noise is irregular, the more you need to renormalize. So, to deal with, for example, PAM in dimension 3, you need higher order expansion, not only a remainder that is 12th order, but 3rd order. So you need to study a product between u and psi when u is given by that. So you just use the linearity of the resonant term, and then you use your corrector. So you have all those terms that can be ill-defined. And this is where you might have to again expand u1 and u2. And this is why you not only need u to be paracontrolled, but you also need the derivative u1 and u2 to be paracontrolled. So we work with paracontrol expansions that are system. And the order that we need the order at which we need an expression for the derivative depends on the regularity of the associated term. For GPAM in dimension 3 and GKPZ in dimension 1 plus 1, that is a space-time white noise, we only need to work with a third-order paracontrol system. That is, u is given by three different terms and the remainder is 4th order. And then you ask a triangular system for each derivative depending on its regularity.
So your system is indexed by multi-indexed? Like
yeah, exactly. It's I have for u, I have references function that is z1, z2, z3.
Yeah.
And I have also a higher order derivative for u. That is here this set. This is like words you can do.
All words, yes. Do you have an algebraic structure on these words?
Yeah, that's, we actually don't need it for those two equations. We can do by hand, but yeah, for normalization, we expect that.
What type of structure you have?
It is not clear now. Yeah, because, well, we can discuss this, but it is not clear now what structure, but it's words, so you have, for example, op algebra of words, structure. There is a work by Oshino, where he use op algebra structure of words to get continuity estimation on different characters. So we need to work with a paracontrol system. On this slide, I sum up the general methodology for solving singular SPDs in this framework. So first, I take paracontrol systems, that is a paracontrol function, and also paracontrol structure for the derivative UI. And those functions only depend on the noise. And the rougher the noise is, the highest we have to take the expansion, because we need that U sharp times xi is well defined. And the function z are to be determined later by the equation. Then we perform using paracontrol expansion and continuity results. We get a paracontrol expression for the nonlinear, the right hand side of our equation. So here we take pt for u, but here, since we might have, for example, product, we have to use the paraproduct that is given by the product. And then we try to perform a fixed point. That is, we impose a condition on the ZE, on the Z and the Y to get a stable solution space and perform a classic fixed point to get a unique solution in this solution space given by paracontrol function. Okay, for the nonlinear generalized prime equation, we have a nonlinearity here, so we need a paracontrol description for this nonlinearity, and this is actually given by the formula that I show at the beginning. But this is more in the spirit of the Taylor formula from Regulatory Structure, because here I have an alpha order term, here I have a 2 alpha order term, and here I have a 3 alpha order term plus a remainder, so I have a grading of the regularity. It was not the case on the formula. Here it's not the case. This is only alpha order, this is only alpha order. So we need a bit of work to get a paracontrol expression of this kind using different operators. And this is more in the spirit of regularity structure and Taylor expansion that we need.
Is there a general procedure to get this kind of expansion?
Well, basically, we only need a third order to deal with GPAM and GKPZ, so we didn't compute it.
But you have a general formula.
We have a general formula.
And if you want to go to higher order, like not right.
We have a general formula at this level.
Yeah.
But it's not
for 4 or 5?
We have a general formula at any order.
Any order, yeah.
But under the form where each term is alpha order. You need a bit of computation to get into this form, and we don't have a general form because we don't need it, we didn't look into it. For Japan and GKPZ, we didn't need it, so.
Oh, it's like for general GKPZ that you just need to go up to order 2 for your Taylor expansion?
We don't need more, so we can compute, but yeah, it should be okay. But for the previous one, we have a general formula. So using this kind of result, we can deal with nonlinear equation. OK, so now I'm going to talk about the quasi-linear problem. So recall that the problem is the following. The Laplacian of U is of the same regularity of the noise. So we have an indefinite term in the leaning order term. So what we do is we linearize around the initial condition, and we take an initial condition smooth enough for this to make sense. And then we want to solve this with the same idea that we use for the semilinear problem, using that this should be small for a small horizon time, that is u close to mu zero. So we basically linearize is a leading order term around the initial condition. And now, for technical reasons, I need an operator in the R model form, so I change a bit the equation. So actually, I work with this equation and not this one, because I want to work with all the part product tools associated to this operator, and we need it to be in the R model form. So what we are trying to solve is this equation using the a priori data that this can be small, is small for smaller horizon time. So this is like in Ebenstock, we rewrite the equation in order to treat it in a more semi-linear spirit. So now, getting a power control expansion of this term is deal with in the semi-linear problem, and now we have to get a power control expression for those terms in order to build a solution space that is stable and perform a fixed point. So we consider all the tools I introduced to you, but instead of the Laplacian, I take this operator because I have to use the right tools for the equation. So I have to use the same operator here. And what we want is an expression, a power control expression of this at the right order to do as in the semi-linear setting, to build a solution space and perform a fixed point. Okay, so for example, I do the same. I take a formal solution of QGPM. I have this expression. I get rid of terms that are smoother than the noise. So here I keep these terms because LU has the same regularity as the noise, but all other terms go in the remainder. So I start from a first order expression of U, and I try to write things to get a stable form. So using again different continuity results, I can show that if U is power controlled by Z, we can rewrite this like this. And so when we apply when we reinverse this operator, we get not a function power controlled by Z, but by two functions. So this is not stable. If I take a function power controlled by Z, then if I do one iteration for the Picard fixed point, I do not get a function power controlled by Z. So I cannot perform my fixed point. So well, I can take another function. So I take Z and I take this as a function. I do the same, I reverse the equation, and then I inverse, and I get a third term. So what I see is this is not stable. Why? Because every time I get a function, every time U is power controlled by a reference function Z, then it has to be also power controlled by this term. So I cannot have a finite number of reference functions to power control U. I need it to verify this condition. So for the first order calculus, it's quite what we do is we take a solution U that is power controlled by an affinity number of alpha order functions that are given by this, and this set is stable by this operation. But we need some condition on convergence because we have infinite sums of alpha order function. So it is not clear what we can do. So we write the formal equation to try to see if what we are doing is making sense at the formally at the level of the equation. So U is given by an infinite sum of alpha order function. And I have the same for the right hand side. I have this expression. And I formally identify terms, so U0 is given by this, U1 is given by this, U2 is given by this, because when I pass this operator to Z0, it gives me Z1. So if I formally identify each term, this gives me this relation, so U0 should be U. There is a mistake, this is for PAM. U0 should be F of U, so F of U, and yes. This is QPAM, so okay. So this is for QPAM with F equal identity. So U0 should be U, and U should satisfy this formula. So we have an explicit expression for the formal fixed point of the equation that is given by this. And now we can try to see if this makes sense and if we have a convergent infinite sum. And this is the case because we want to see if this is a alpha order function, so we have an explicit formation. We have an explicit formula for UI, for ZY, so we plug it here. And this is where we use that epsilon u is small for a small horizon time. Here, since L is uniformly elliptic, this is bounded by a constant, an epsilon of t, and this is small enough for t, for a large enough, a small enough horizon time. So this is indeed a convergent sum for a small enough horizon time, and what we are doing is well defined. And this allows us to define a solution space that is stable for the equation, and we this allows us to solve QPAM and QGPAM in dimension 2. In the work from Martina Fonova, Debuche, and Bayel, they did not need infinite expansion because the noise is a space noise. So this operator, you can show that this coincides with you can show that here you can show that this and this looks like the same thing, and you can perform you can build a fixed point using that it is a space noise because you don't really see the time dependency here. So that's why they are able to do it for QGPAM in dimension 2 using only a first order expansion with one term. But if we are willing to deal with space time white noise or QGPAM in dimension 3, this doesn't work. And for QGPAM in dimension 3, we can do the same, but we actually get the same terms that we get for GPAM. We only, again, need the set of reference functions to be stable by this operator. For example, for GPAM in dimension 3, like you said, we have this ill-defined term that we have to renormalize. And since we need the set of references functions to be stable by this, we have to put an arbitrary number of terms like this in all the places. And this gives us a very large set of things to renormalize, but with the same final structure of GPAM. If you represent this by 3, it's like if when you get a structure, you take 2 trees to get a new one, but you have to add edges to represent this operator, and you get very long legs that represent those operators.
It's like you stretch your tree.
Yeah, exactly. You have the same algebraic structure, but every time you take 2 trees to create a new one, you have to put an arbitrary number of terms like this in your term. So you get an infinite number of trees, but the structure is basically the same as the one of GPAM. Okay, so thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Any questions?
I have a question. Can you also have a nonlinear term in front of the time derivative? Can you, like a1 of u dt u?
Well,
I mean, it seems like it should be similar, but I'm not.
Well, I think if you do a clever change of variable, you can show that it's basically, if you can do this, you can do what you are talking about, I think. We can discuss it after. I think by the change of variable, it's basically the same.
Yeah, and what about the case in which you replace your diffusion coefficient by a non-divergence form of right? I mean, I'm thinking of an elliptic, a uniform elliptic matrix. Then your operator L in this case, I mean, your method rely a lot on the structure of the operator L?
Well, I needed to read our model form in order to have all those product toolbox tools. So
I'm talking more about the operator, because in this case you are not considering, I mean, you don't need to consider cross derivatives.
Yeah.
So in this other case you should, I mean, could you like take the proper operator for that?
And if you change to an operator of my form, I think you get a first order derivative terms on the right hand side. It should change, and this should be okay, I think. Mm-hmm. But what I'm using is that in here, this operator are the one that I use to build the paraproducts. So I can get first order term and second order term of the operator I used for the paraproducts. For example, if I put a Laplacian term, I cannot do it. I need it to be in this form. That's why I need a first order correction. Because I can't work with the Laplacian, I need it, I need to have.
I have a question that you say you need to start with some nice initial condition.
Yes, basically the product with the white noise, the noise is well defined.
Okay, so your solution actually does not live in that nice space, so you cannot restart your solution at a later time.
Well, the solution lives in the power control space, so we know how to. I could start with a. I'm not sure what is the question.
Whether you can. So right now your nice space is a deterministic nice space, right?
Yeah.
So whether you can modify it so that you can actually restart your solution.
But basically what we need is for this operator to be regularizing. So we need it to be well defined and. Crash other estimates. Okay. Yeah, it's not so clear for me. Yeah. Smooth enough works, but less.
Yeah.
Did you also do the stochastic bounds?
The randomization?
The stochastic bounds?
The randomization of the.
Well, no, we did not do the randomization. It's forthcoming. Well, we are going to study this after. It's only the analytic part of the problem.
Any questions?
Did you compute your triple brackets for RathPath?
No.
Yeah, triple brackets. And your expansion, you have?
Yeah.
Triple brackets.
Yeah, we did that.
Any further questions? Well, that's nice. Speak again.